welcome, everybody. Okay. Does anyone on the board have any modifications to tonight's agenda? Okay, it's too long. Hearing none, the agenda is adopted as presented.
Can I make a comment? Can I make a comment on that?
If you wish, go ahead.
Okay, so we've all been watching the news about the coronavirus. Couple things happened today. New Rochelle is in a lockdown. All of the Catholic schools in the Bay Area are going to be shutting down. And I imagine it'll be a short period of time before Marin schools will be shut down. We really should be talking tonight about adjustments to the remainder of the year in lieu of this challenge. No one knows the future, but I don't actually see anything on the agenda that acknowledges the disruption that we're about to undergo. So I don't know if we can work it in tonight, but I really think it really affects all the information that follows.
Okay, thank you. Okay, item C, the consent calendar. Does anyone on the board have any questions about the February 11th meeting minutes or the bills paid? Hearing none, does any member of the public wish to comment?
There's always lots to, yeah, I do. Okay. Speak.
Go right ahead.
You know, there's always actually a lot of information here that gets handled real quick. The question I have is, I see that Bill Hansel has submitted another $2,800, which seems rather light for the amount of work that he's done since his left.
Can I ask a quick question? We are talking about the meetings from last minute, the draft meeting minutes and the consent calendar, so.
And the bills?
Yeah. Okay, sorry, I didn't see the bills. Sorry, go ahead, Stephen. You are appropriate.
Okay. Please, at least allow me to speak before you interrupt me. I'm just wondering, are we actually capturing the cost of Hansel design? It seems awfully light, Bill, there for the amount of work that I know he's been doing. And if we are behind, if we're running up a big deficit, how much is it? And when are we going to learn how much his fees are costing the taxpayers? That's really the only comment I have on the budget or on the bills paid.
Very good. Thank you for your comments. Anybody else from the public?
Be nice to get responses from some of these questions. They're not really just, you know, you talk about being a public servant. One of the ways you can serve the public is being forthright.
Understood, thank you.
Which means that you respond to questions. I know you don't think of it that way, but I think of it as a democracy.
Right, and those questions should be asked of staff outside of the forum.
Well, how about we ask our elected representatives? I believe you're probably gonna seek re-election. And so these are the kinds of things that we don't know. I ask every time, and we never get a response other than, thank you for your question, thank you for your comment.
Okay. Again, no one else from the public has any questions or comments. May I have a motion to approve the consent calendar?
I motion to approve the consent calendar.
Second. Okay, thank you. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. Moving on. Okay, item D, public comment, open time for items not on the agenda. Bill?
Yes.
Item I brought up several times before and is getting a little bit redundant is, or are, the three drinking fountains in the park. You have one by court one, one by court two, and one in the mini park. I happen to see the one in the mini park probably 3 or 4 days a week, as he and I do our 2 to 3 miles, because I always have a package to drop off in the garbage can. So I check it. It is usually stopped up. I send an email to Eric and Luke saying, hey guys, it's plugged again. And usually it'll get unplugged, and a couple days later, it's plugged again. And my question is, and I've hit it in emails, what can be done to replace those so we don't have this plugging problem? I don't go around and check the two by the tennis court, but I don't, maybe once a month when I walk the dogs, but they're always plugged. And I don't know if anybody else in the room ever does that, but it seems like maybe it's ironic, maybe it's me, to walk around and find out they're plugged. And I've seen suggestions to Luke on, hey, these are alternatives that work. Maybe like the one over by on the other side of the fire department. That maybe we do. How do I, or who should I be talking to get this to happen? I think it's very non-professional, the CSD, to have drinking fountains out there that don't work. I mean, people want to drink. There's no water. And I know there's problems at the mini park, and I've told Luke on it, is I found out I'm crammed full of crap in the drinking fountain. I don't know how you prevent that. Have no idea, but I have found it. It's about the same thing as people dumping their full garbage into the garbage can and all over the ground down in the mini park. And he gets emails from me probably 2-3 times a week, and I know Eric knows because he gets a copy of every email. So that's my question to the board. Who do I talk to, or what shall we do to get this problem corrected? I have seen solutions for drinking fountains, which are very low budget, that would do the job. I don't know. I just get frustrated is when you go up to a drinking fountain and you turn the water on and the water doesn't flow down.
Mm-hmm. Understood. Okay, I have a question.
Sure.
Wasn't there something at the last meeting, a recommendation of how we could fix these water fountains? Am I recalling this correctly?
I don't know that there's a recommendation on how to fix them. It's something that we deal with several times a week. To be clear, they do work. Water does come out of them. You can't get a drink of water. The drainage gets backed up on a lot of them because, as Bill pointed out just now, they get stuffed full of wood chips or any other things that are around that kids take their hands on and shove into the actual bowl of the water fountain itself.
Well, let me clarify on that one. I don't believe that. I've seen it happen a few times. But I don't believe you can walk around the park and find it with all of them. You find nothing in the drinking fountain on many occasions. And I've been in here 4 or 5 times now, emails 2-3 days a week, and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And I believe what Eric's saying is, yeah, it does happen. Maybe 5% of the time, yes, as I mentioned, I did see it happen. But there's the other 90%, the damn things don't drain. We need a better system for draining them, or we need to replace them. And there are other alternatives to do this. The one over by the fire department, it works. I don't know if it doesn't maybe get the people over there, who knows. But I think it's something that either the board designates somebody to look into. I thought maybe the park and recreation director was looking into it, but apparently nothing's happened on that. And maybe the executive director has, but nothing's happened on that. All I do is pay the damn taxes, and I'd like to see it be working. That's what I'm paying for. Maybe there's something I don't understand in that. But I know there's always tax increases, I don't know where they go, because it sure as hell isn't taking care of the problem. Thank you.
You Thank you for your comment. Okay, this is a repetitive issue. Can we get that assigned and have somebody look into this, please?
Yeah, I mean, we've looked into it. Like I said, we have the park maintenance crew goes through there multiple times per week and tries to flush out the line the best they can. It's an issue with the drainage line. It's not replacing the fountains and stuff that we budgeted at this point. Obviously, I don't need to explain to anybody that we do have limited resources and a lot of priority projects.
I understand that.
What I'm understanding then from the executive director is this is not a priority in the running of the service district to make sure the drinking fountains work. Is that correct, Eric?
At this point in time, it's not a project that we have budgeted nor that we have planned.
Do you plan in the next 10 years to budget? Because in the last 2 years that I've been bitching about it, you have not budgeted.
Okay. Well, I'm not going to comment out to what I plan to do or what we're going to do in the next 10 years, but it is something we will examine.
Okay, and when should I, may I ask, when should we expect an answer? And this should come from the board to the executive director. When should we have an answer with firm numbers in it?
I'll take this offline. If you don't mind, I'll figure out how to respond.
All right, and you can respond to me, Jeff?
I'll do my best to do that.
Okay, thanks. My number's in the phone book, and Eric and Luke has my email.
Understood. Yes, Stephen.
I have two comments. First of all, there are four drinking fountains, and one of them never clogs, and that's in the fireman picnic area, and that's because it's designed to drain on the ground. This is similar to the fountain that I actually emailed copies to Eric and Luke several times. Basically, it's a very simple design that built with redwood. And there's no problems with drainage because it just goes into a dry well. And there's also commercial things that you can do mm-hmm. that you don't have to, you don't have to construct it, but it's so easy to construct. One guy could do it in an afternoon. So this isn't really a problem that should be, we should be talking about. It's disappointing. I guess Eric didn't see the email, but he did receive two of those emails with two photos. I'll be happy to forward this to you, Jeff, so you know what we're talking about. Like I said, it's not a big deal. I would even volunteer to do it if you paid me for the materials. It's so simple. But the reason I'm... So that's just one topic. The other topic is... transparency and dealing with the public both in the meeting and out of the meeting. You probably heard that Bill Shea and I had a little toe-to-toe last week regarding the maintenance facility. I pointed out that both Bill and Eric at the Planning Commission said, hey, we're going to back up, we're going to do a T-turn basically at the gate, which would put the vehicles onto the horseshoe pit. I said, hey, so the horseshoe pit's going to be ruined, where are we going to move the horseshoe pit? And I was basically shut down by Bill. Things got a little heated, walked away, and it's really unfortunate. Bill's first response is, we'll bring it up at the meeting, and we know how it is at the meeting. You take comments, you never actually have a conversation. And yet, this is really the essence of the problems that we have here. The fact that you guys feel like your role is basically to be rulers, not leaders. And I just think that you know, we're missing out on a lot of opportunity to work together to improve things. You know, this fountain issue was something that Linda and I and Bill had talked about. Hey, there's a solution. Let's offer a solution. We offered the solution, and apparently it was ignored. So, yeah, I mean, I echo everything that Bill says. Guys, you know, get on it. You know, we've got a solution here. Are you going to fix things, or are you going to just say it's not a priority. And who are you to say it's not a priority? Because you're hearing from the public that says, hey, it's a priority. So I just think it's just, you know, basic respect and understanding. And I'll do my best, Bill, to be more respectful of you. I realize that I was a little out of place there, and I do apologize for that. But I do believe all of us are good-hearted people, believe in the community, want the best things. And I'd like you to keep that in mind and think about that as the base point of working together to make this community better. That's all.
Any other comment? No?
No.
Okay. All right. Moving on to district matters. And the draft, the first draft, preliminary draft of the fiscal year 2020-21 budget. Any questions at all from the board?
Mm-hmm. No, I mean, these are projections, but I guess the one thing that we should be considering is if they do change and if this continues, the shutting down of various things. I don't think that they're going to shut down outdoor camps and stuff, but maybe the adult rec programs and stuff like that, like those classes. Do we have a contingency for the funding that we thought we were going to be getting if those sorts of things do get canceled in terms of how we might make those things up?
So that I can hardly hear you, and I'm sitting right next to you.
Sorry.
That's okay. Would you repeat what you're asking?
Yeah, I'm just asking if we have some contingencies for the programs that we have that will be going on indoors that are like classes and stuff that we have been holding, and we have budget items that we're thinking we're going to be getting money from them, and just what are we going to do if we don't get that
money? Well, a couple answers. First, then, we're on the direct line of communication with both the county OES office as well as HHS. We're following their leads in terms of recommendations and where they stand, and they are doing a very good job monitoring and communicating about the situation. In terms of set contingency plans, no, not at this time, but you also have to remember that if certain programs, camps, adult programs don't happen, there's also expense that is related with those that won't be there as well. So it's not like just that revenue disappears, but the expense stays. So those are all, I mean, this is a new world for everybody. Those are all bridges we will all have to cross. But yes, I mean, we have talked about these items. And in the meantime, you know, we're looking at it. This is going into next year. So if we're continuing this into that far in time, we're going to have much larger issues in hand here.
Okay. Yeah, a lot of these things are fall under the category of opportunity cost.
Yeah.
And that is, you know, we've got, you know, capacity to generate revenue, et cetera,
right,
et cetera, but we don't have the opportunity.
Yeah, no, so. I agree. I just want to make sure that everybody
knew
where and when.
It has not gone unnoticed.
Yeah, it's sort of hard to not notice it. Okay, I reviewed this you know, fairly exhaustively, but you know, it is very preliminary.
Preliminary with a capital P. I'm not quite as far along at this point in time as I hope to be, especially, I mean, this has actually evolved since, you know, this was as of Wednesday of last week, so almost a week ago, so obviously more work has been put into it, but I had to stop for this purpose on Wednesday because there's a lot of other work that goes into formatting it, data input, and getting it ready to be published. For this draft here, you know, some of the things that are in here that are pretty well set, and I tried to make point of this in my memo, are some of the larger drivers, especially on the expense side. Full-time staffing has been updated throughout in terms of what models and anticipated for next year. Pensions that are related to that. The one payroll-related cost that isn't set yet is on the workers' comp side, and that's simply because we haven't gotten the updated information from the carrier yet. Usually we have it by now. I actually call them and say, hey, how come we haven't got this yet? And they're taking a slightly different approach. Agencies on the last day of February, were required to submit all of their estimations for next year. So they've gotten all of those, and they are waiting now to calculate those out before they establish if there's any other rates. And then obviously, a big factor for us will be our experience modification factor, which takes into account on a workers' comp side claims paid on average over the last 3 years against industry norm. Ours this particular year is fairly high, so once we get all of that information, that line will change. In terms of all the rec program drivers, those will be updated this week, next week, and the park and rec budgets will be updated and go into the park and rec commission packet, so we'll have that done by that time. We've just all got kind of a little backed up. People been out, illnesses, everything else. So we just haven't had the chance to get far enough along. That said, final budget doesn't approve for another 2 months. So it obviously will all be brought up to speed. I'm just trying to get some of the primary things that were known that didn't, that represented large chunk costs. Obviously, staffing is, you know, one of the big ones, pensions, one of the big ones, those are some of our primary expenditure drivers. I did update and go through and looked at on, I didn't do anything with taxes yet, including allocations. That's why you kind of see some wonky totals of revenue versus expense by department, because I use the taxes to balance those out once we know. I actually spoke with the budget director from the county and got their projections as to what they are thinking. Obviously, that's a countywide number, and you look at a very small pocket like ours, it's different. And actually, just today, started analyzing, you know, 3-year trends and year over year. So those will get updated by the next round too, so we'll have a better sense of what's going on there. But the special taxes, I have updated based primarily on what the updated numbers were. From a data perspective from last year, because those always usually increase. You know, one is based on square footage. Well, people add on, things happen, square footage tends to grow. And then as other units come on, our parks change to some degree. So those numbers are updated, and they anticipate, even though it won't come on until the next board meeting, the CPI for this year was 2.5%. I did factor that into there, and easily be
that's the Bay Area.
Bay Area, year over year as of December end of year, which is our measurement point.
Very good.
Yeah, so I tried to get a lot of that in there. And then I didn't really do anything with the actuals column. Right now, those do run through February. But January, February haven't been thoroughly reviewed, so those are subject to some levels of journaling. I mean, the numbers aren't going to change a heck of a lot, with the exception of some of these that get contra'd. Health benefits has a contra that goes to it because we withhold from every employee's paycheck. We haven't journaled that back yet, as well as some things like on the memberships and dues and other items like that. So they'll change a little bit, but right now, the numbers that are in there mostly just to look at it and say, okay, here's what our 1920 budget was, here's what we're doing at approximately 2/3 throughout the year, and then here's where 2021 is. And so this will change a lot by the next meeting. That said, a lot of the primary drivers have certainly been updated.
Is the county usually a little bit late in their estimates of tax revenues and things like that, or do you expect that by next meeting they'll have a fairly good handle on that?
I think we have a good handle on what their projections are. Mm-hmm. That said, I guess, what are you asking? Are you asking about projections, or are you asking about actuals?
No, I'm asking you about projections.
They project out every year. Right now, they're projecting just for current secured, which is the primary property tax, at 5% countywide. We don't necessarily experience that, but I will. What I tend to do is soften that number a little bit, and then I look at what we are actually projecting for at the end of this year based on the 55% that we collected in December. And then I, usually we use something more along the lines of a 2.5 to 3% growth, just because, again, our sample size is very small, and the county as a whole tends to outpace Marinwood specifically.
Right, understood. And it seems to me that there's been at least one year in the past, recent past, where they were a little bit
A couple of years ago, they didn't really put out projections, and you know, also keeping in mind that the county does two-year budgets. So they do, they put together a biannual budget with a amendment usually on the in-between year. But I literally just this past week talked to the budget manager directly, and he's the one who told me that, you know, on the secure, but all the smaller ones, they don't put out projections on those things anymore. Yeah, that's why I just do a trend analysis and look at usually no more than 3 years. What have the last 3 years been for each one of the individual tax lines? And that gives us a pretty good sense. And then I try to be a little bit conservative because I would rather under budget on revenue and overperform than the other way around.
Understood. I wanted to comment, I'm pleased to see that the relationships between the district and the water devils has been truncated, and they are now doing their own payroll, et cetera, so.
Yeah, so, and that was another one of the big changes when you look in here. You know, for years and years and years, we were kind of a makeshift payroll agent for them. And both agencies have kind of walked away from that, and they are doing their own, and with that, their own workers' comp insurance. You know, so it's more of a use agreement at this point in time, as it should be, to be quite honest.
Very good.
Yeah, I think it works out well for both agencies. They're actually saving money doing it this way.
Exactly, yeah. Any more questions or comments?
I'm good with this, yeah.
Anything else?
Again, my apologies. I wish I would have had it a little bit farther along. Way it is this time.
Understood. Okay, questions from the public on the draft budget? Stephen.
Yeah, so we've all had a weather report, and the weather report is our hurricanes bearing down on us or another natural disaster. Now, I don't think we should panic, but I do think it is the responsible thing to have a contingency plans in place. So, some of the things that I see probable is that camps will be canceled, and our firemen are going to be working extra hard doing ambulance calls. You know, the data that we're getting, it's all mixed up all over the board. Probably the safety guys have more current information than I would, but they say there's a 1% mortality rate. We're in a community of 6,000 people. That would be 60 deaths that we would maybe experience in a very short period of time. That's a lot of ambulance calls, a lot of heartache out there, even though it's hurting certain populations. I'm not suggesting that you throw out everything that you have here, but I do think that saying, getting a good what if response together as a is the responsible thing to do, as opposed to hopefully the county will tell us what to do. I think we should have this in place. I believe, I'm gonna guess, that the schools are gonna be closed down within a couple weeks, maybe after spring break. Just the way that the case is going here. The cases are actually doubling every 2 days. And if you think about that math, it's pretty astounding. Now we're gonna, it's gonna pass, hopefully during the warm months, maybe it'll go away. We don't really know at this point. But, I mean, this is the subject of maybe a special meeting to discuss the options here. Nothing really should be approved with this budget until you have that contingent budget set aside, because it will affect virtually everything. Manpower, you know, how many kids are running around here, all kinds of things. Public safety is very important. I won't bring up the public safety issue. Well, I will bring up the public safety issues with the lack of basic video surveillance, locking up the bathrooms, other safety concerns. I don't know how often things get sanitized, but there should be, as of today, in place, you know, crews really making sure everything is spick and span. I believe children and the elderly are most at risk, and we have a heck of a lot of kids and a bunch of elderly people. So let's do the responsible thing. This is the leadership that you're all called on to do, and you know, make us proud.
Thank you, Stephen. Okay, anything else? Moving on to item E2, district manager's report. Eric?
Sure. I've put a few things in here. One of the things I didn't put in here, and a little bit more clarity actually came about over the weekend, even more so. As everybody knows, we have two different ballot measures, specific to Marin Woods, Measure G and Measure H. Both of those are hitting up at over 72% approval right now. There might be a few more lingering ballots to be counted, but there's not going to be enough that's going to bring that number down. So I would, while it hasn't been official, I would consider both of those have passed, which is good. Also, as a related measure, Measure C, with each ballot count continues to rise. I'm sure Chief Sinnott might have something else to say about this in his report, but at last count, that one is at a little over 69% approval, and it needs 66.7. So it's looking positive for that one to pass as well, and that will certainly impact the district because it will put resources into specific for Marinwood and Lucas Valley.
Quick question.
Yes, sir.
Do you have any idea when final is final?
30 days.
30 days?
Yep.
From
the date of the election.
Date of the election.
Yep.
I see. Okay.
Yeah, they're required by law to have it canvassed by that point in time.
By Easter.
I say so. Or April 2nd. But yeah, I mean, and the elections department is good about it, and you know, they're also good about doing their due diligence, and they just put out another update, I think it was yesterday, that had the latest round of additions to it. So the numbers I gave you were as of today, last night. On the park maintenance, we are moving forward with that. We've contacted seven different structural engineers, started to receive some response. That's kind of the next step, moving forward with that, so we can really start to plan that forward. One of the bigger challenges right now is, I kind of put in here a note, one of our first stages is going to be that initial site prep, which is going to be the demolition and the removal of the existing buildings. That said, we're going to have a long period of time between where we're still going to need to be able to maintain our maintenance operations. So we are trying to be as creative as we can on that front, potentially looking into ordering some cargo units that can be used temporarily to store holes and things. I've reached out to some other partner agencies inquiring about temporary space for some of our larger items. So we're just going to, we will figure it out. We have no choice because I anticipate the it could be up to a year from the time that we begin the site prep to the time that the new facility is concluded. So that is, of the immediate concern.
You're talking about temporary off-site storage?
If needed. Ideally, no. But, we are exploring every potential option and need so that we can maintain operations as efficiently as possible. At the end of the day, that year is going to be much harder than any of the years leading up to it for our maintenance staff. But when this project is done, their operations are going to become much more efficient. So sometimes you just got to sacrifice a little for the greater good. We're working with them on it, and Luke and myself, and Phil has come up with a lot of creative ideas as well. The AmeriCorps application, I actually do have a slight update on this. I got a call today from the coordinator of this app. We have, not officially, but he informed me that we have been awarded. However, there's a catch. And Tiburon also submitted an application. So what the powers that be have decided is that they're going to assign one team to both agencies for a 12-week stretch. So I'm getting together tomorrow with the personnel from Center Bell, who have been incredibly helpful on this entire application. We're going to brainstorm a little bit. There's a lot of different ways we can take that. We can run it concurrently. We can say, great, you can have the team for 6 weeks, and then we'll take the team for 6 weeks, or vice versa. So we're going to figure out what the best solution is for that. At the end of the day, we're not going to have a complete team for a 12-week assignment. But getting a 6-week assignment out of this is certainly a big win, and can really do a lot of good work and make a lot of progress. So there'll be some updates on that.
Wasn't Tiburon one of the towns that opted out?
We made that known as in the initial conversations, but they were the only agency that opted out of the wildfire thing. And yeah, so, but it is what it is. So at the end of the day, I will gladly take a 6-week assignment over an 8-week assignment on this. So this is a good thing. And just the economy and value that we're going to get out of this is tenfold. So that's great. And then the only other item I put on there is re-engaging with LAFCO and representatives from the city of Santa Fe, as well as the county, and getting those conversations, as I put in here, and admittedly it had been a while since we had met, scheduling conflicts, and then just this rash of everybody having a round of illness causes to cancel plenty of meetings. So next meeting is actually on the book for Thursday, I believe. It's either Thursday or Friday or Wednesday.
This week?
Yeah.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Yeah, so when I wrote next week here, I wrote that last week.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
It's this week.
Yep. Okay. Very good. Any feedback or questions?
Eric, is that during the day, the LAFCO meeting?
Yeah. I mean, but it's not a LAFCO meeting. Oh, okay. This is myself. If Chief Senate's available, he may very well be there. This is the LAFCO EO. A representative from the county's chief administrator office, and there's also a somebody from Santa Fe City Finance Department that is part of this initial process as well. And I will say, you know, I take my hat off to Jason Free, who really has pushed this. He's the executive officer for LAFCO. He's reached out. He spoke to the labor groups. I know, I think it was Captain Brackett sat down with them at one point, along with Sean Bay, who is our shop steward, and I think Captain Salvatella came along. Representatives from Santa Fe were there too. He's pushing this, which is what we pushed for in the MSR, is for LAFCO to take the lead. And you know, to Jason's credit, he's been very active in it. It's not his fault that we haven't had a chance to meet. I know he actually even flew down invited, but timing didn't work out for me personally. But he flew down in early January to Orange County to attend a workshop that was very specific towards agencies merging features or departments or things like this, specifically for this initiative on LAFCO's dime. Which was, you know, this is a workshop through LAFCO, so he got some good information from them. So we're moving forward, but I hope I can give you a better update here in the next meeting.
Very good.
Yeah. But to answer your question, I mean, this isn't a public meeting. This is an internal staff meeting.
Yeah. Questions? Questions from the public? Stephen?
Who's representing the public, or rather the taxpayers, at that meeting? I'm really interested. As you know, we 80% of our firefighting stuff that we do happens in the city of San Rafael, yet we pay virtually 100% of the that cost, as well as the pensions, and we actually pay for the privilege of being managed. I like our fire department, but I think the taxpayers are really getting hosed, and you know, Eric mentioned he's talking to the labor groups. They're obviously very important, but also keep in mind that the citizens really have a lot to gain or lose from this negotiation. So I would very much hope that one of you attend on our behalf, the taxpayers' behalf, to make sure that the negotiations go well for our community. So, and then one other question. You know, Eric mentioned he's soliciting bids for structural engineers, all sorts of things. I think that's great. What's the budget for this project? And why don't we know yet? I mean, how do you solicit bids without knowing what the budgets are? Are we just kind of doing like, well, however long it takes, however much it costs, or are we going to try to contain the cost? We certainly had that opportunity with a pre-engineered building, which would actually include structural engineering, but we don't have it in this custom design building. But why don't we have a budget? What is the secret? And it's going to come out eventually, but why is it being hidden from the public view? Or do you feel that it's too expensive and you're going to get a lot of pushback? Yeah, you know I'll push back, but what about everybody else? I mean, you're spending our money, the community's money. I mean, don't you feel responsible to the people who put you in office?
Once again, thank you. Yes, I would like to have a better handle on what this is going to cost, but I think we're still going to be gathering information that will allow us to give you a reasonable estimate as opposed to a wild-ass guess, and that's where we are now. That's the best I can tell you. We're looking forward to that day as much as you are, believe me. Bill.
Jeff, you're talking about, you mentioned about a citizen's involvement in the negotiations, contracts. I got a minor in my MBA in labor relations, and I spent 5 years at Armour Foods negotiating with 5 unions, and I'd be happy to be a citizen's volunteer if requested.
Very good. Thank you, Bill.
Can I clarify here?
Yes.
These meetings at LAFCO are not a negotiation in any way, shape, or form. These are simply research and learning what is possible and what are the legalities and the steps needed to make them happen.
Understood. For your edification, I also volunteered quite a long time ago to participate. Was told we'll make that decision at some point.
Okay.
And yeah, right now it's sort of information.
Just let me know if you desire.
Right, absolutely. You know, for all intents and purposes, I would love to say that this is a cookie-cutter type of thing that's going to be very easily managed.
But negotiations are never easily managed.
Particularly when the term merger comes up and when, I think Chief Senator will remember my comment, we are a island of CalPERS in a sea of MCERA organizations. That is a predicament that is going to make a merger a very difficult proposition. So these are conversations that are going to have to take place over a period of time, mm-hmm. and there are going to be some big issues that are going to need to be worked out in order to move forward.
Be very interested to volunteer to be a participant.
Understood.
Just want you to be the chaperone, Chad. I mean, you know, they have interest, which I respect, but we have interest.
Absolutely, understood.
Yeah.
Understood. Okay. Any other comments on the district manager's report? Okay, thank you all. Moving on to fire department matters.
Chief? Thank you. Good evening, everybody. I'd like to start with some good news, and that is that Chief Darren White, the current chief of Oakland Fire Department, has accepted the position of chief for the San Rafael and Marin Fire Departments, so we're very excited about that. I've had the opportunity to briefly meet him. Jeff and I were part of an interview panel where we interviewed the chief. He scored obviously quite well across the board over the course of 3 days of interviews, and has formally accepted the position. He starts on April 15th, so soon I'll have a replacement here. But we're all very excited about that.
Absolutely.
Now,
if we could only talk to the Marin IJ about their term, poached.
Who? Yeah, I'm not sure how they use that.
Oh no, that was somewhat derogatory in my opinion. But we're really happy to see it.
I think everybody's very happy about the selection. We're looking forward to him starting with us. On to more serious business, an item that's not on my report that has developed quickly, though, and has been mentioned several times over tonight, is the COVID-19 emergency. City of San Rafael is following the County of Marin. We're going to be declaring an emergency, state of emergency, or local emergency tomorrow. What has happened here recently is a vast amount of resources, time, attention, materials has been devoted towards trying to, we can't say stay ahead of this issue because I don't think anybody's staying ahead of it, but trying to deal with it as best we can. in a city of Santa, in a city the size of San Rafael, it affects multiple departments, not only emergency first responders, including our Marinewood colleagues here, but departments such as Park and Rec, Community Services, Library, all sorts of different departments were all affected. So staff is in the process of preparing contingency plans, new cleaning policies, personal protective equipment policies for first responders. We're having daily meetings now, all the department heads and directors. Our emergency manager, Quinn Gardner, has done an amazing job at becoming extremely knowledgeable as to the kind of the scope of this emergency, and is basically directing, advising, and assisting all staff members. In the fire department, we've already had two incidents where we've had to self-isolate staff who were at a very low risk, possibly exposed to COVID patients. In both those cases, it turned out to be negative. But what it showed us is we can basically have several staff members at any one time basically taken out of the game and set aside in self-isolation, hopefully not quarantine, but self-isolation until the patient who we've dealt with has been tested and the test results come back. That can take 2 to 4 days. So in both cases, we had an exposure with 2 employees, and then we had an exposure with 6 employees. And taking 6 employees off of shift and basically self-isolating them is a really big deal. It impacts the organization, and it impacts the employees, because what they're doing is they're returning to their homes, and they're very concerned about their well-being. They're very concerned about the possibility of exposing their family members or their friends. So it's a very high-stress time. Our emergency manager is certain, as has been mentioned here, this is going to get far worse. You know, we're concerned about school closures, daycare closures. Once that happens, then the parents, our employees, they're going to have a difficult time coming to work because they're going to have to be caring for their children. So we're looking at employee shortages in all departments. And of course, this is just San Rafael, this is going to be everybody. As mentioned, there are no schools closed at this point. Mary Jane Burke is going to take it on a basically a school-by-school basis. But I think we all see that this is probably going to deepen and broaden before it starts to improve. So it's going to have an impact on our local economy. We're struggling right now locating supplies, clean supplies, PPE supplies, because everybody's going at it at once right now. Everybody's trying to stock up. So this is basically become up to 50% of kind of daily attention for a lot of staff members is just dealing with the COVID-19 crisis. And so this is going to be the long term. Not sure if this is going to subside as, you know, the spring and summer weather gets here, kind of like the flu, it subsides. We're just nobody's sure yet. So it's a major issue. We want to try and contain it and minimize it the best we can. If there are regular Marin County Fire Chiefs Association conference calls that are taking place, we're looking at contingency plans in case agencies have employees that have to be taken offline, expanding our sharing agreements so that we can move personnel around the county. So if one agency has a major issue where several employees have to be taken offline, we can move employees around the county regionally, so we're looking at that right now. So we're all trying to work collectively and as a region, because obviously this is not a local issue, but it's a very serious issue, and it definitely affects first responders from the center. Here in Marinewood, the Marinewood firefighters, I think, have done taken a smart move. The volunteers have been temporarily suspended from ride-alongs. because we're trying to minimize the exposure to first responders, so there's no sense having volunteers on the engine responding to medical aid calls. It would require the department to increase the amount of PPE gear, the personal protective gear, so that the volunteers are equipped. We just don't want to expose them to it. We don't want to have to incur the additional cost or trying to locate extra resources. So just temporarily, they've been suspended from ride-alongs, which I think was a good move, and I supported that. Let's see here. So that's the COVID-19 issue in a nutshell. Next item is the Insurance Service Office, ISO, which evaluates fire departments to assess and set local insurance rates. It's back in Marin County. They've notified all the agencies in Marin that were being reevaluated. That includes Marinwood and San Rafael, who were here 5 years ago. And they're back, and that's a very intensive process to basically furnish them with all the information they need. But we're handling that for both Marinwood and San Rafael, and they are going to be here in late April for a status meeting with us. Marinwood currently has a Class 2 rating, which is excellent. San Rafael is a Class 1, so we both enjoy exceptional levels of ISO ratings. Those are really the highest in the nation, so we want to protect those and maintain them, so we'll be working very hard to meet the obligations with ISO. It's just the timing is terrible with the COVID problem.
And they're not giving us any slack?
Well, I'm thinking of contacting them, and I might reach out to the fire chiefs here in Marin County to see if we can collectively contact the ISO representatives and say, can you give us a delay until possibly the fall? Because by that time, hopefully, we'll have this COVID issue better managed and we'll have more time. But yeah, that's one of the options I'm considering right now. On kind of a, I shouldn't say fun, I find it to be fun. Pulse Point, the Pulse Point app is up and running, it's live. And if you don't have it, you gotta get it, it's free. If you have an iPhone or any kind of wireless device, this basically tells you, I'll hold it up right now, you can't see it, but it basically is showing you every active call, fire or EMS call in Marin County. And then it shows you all the recent calls from the past several hours. So this is real time. If Engine 58 were to get a call right now, it's gonna show up Pulse Point immediately as they're being dispatched. It shows you the location. If it's a residential address, it won't give you the address number, but it will give you the street. If it's a business, it will give you the address number. It will tell you the type of call and what units are responding. What's really neat about this is if you see a column of smoke, you can go on Pulse Point and see what's going on. If it's vegetation, you can see if it's a controlled burn or not, or if it's an actual vegetation fire. You can find its location. It's just a very interesting, usable app. It also, you can sign up for alerts. If there is a full arrest where CPR is needed within 500 feet of your location, and you're signed up, if you've activated the alert, it will alert you to the location that CPR is needed, so that if you are CPR trained, you could possibly assist prior to the arrival of fire and EMS. And there are documented saves, not here in Marin, but Pulse Point has been in operation in other states and other regions, and there's been instances where a member of the public has actually helped save a full arrest patient because they were able to start CPR sooner, and then firefighters arrived and were able to take over care. So it's really interesting, and so I just recommend that everybody get it. Another really interesting project is the Direct Connect pilot project. In Marin County, just like everywhere else, we have a certain percentage of what we call high 911 users. These are people that have different problems, whether they're physical or emotional problems, and they dial 911 on a frequent basis, and we respond, and most of the time we end up transporting them to the hospital because that's what we do. Somebody calls 911 and is complaining of a medical condition. That sometimes it's unnecessary. There are oftentimes more appropriate services that can be aimed towards the patient based on their particular needs. So the Direct Connect pilot project is a basically a coalition of members from fire agencies, from Health and Human Services, and others who are basically focusing on these patients, these high frequency 911 users, actually responding to these calls and trying to identify more appropriate social services that will get them to possibly reduce the number of times they call 911, and also so that they get the help they really need rather than just a trip to the ER, which oftentimes results in them just getting kicked loose soon without really any solution to their problems. So very interesting program, very progressive, very excited. As Eric mentioned, we're awaiting the results of Measure C. It's trending in the right direction. We're all keeping our fingers crossed. We don't want to claim victory yet. It looks like it's going to be victorious, but we don't want to claim that yet because they're still counting absentee ballots and mail-in ballots. But we're hoping that
same thing April 2nd.
Yeah, it's a 30-day. Yeah. And then that will essentially fund the Marin Wildfire JPA, which will then in turn enable us to approach vegetation management from a regional standpoint. Currently, all the fire agencies in Marin do it independently, and it's based on staffing and budget. And oftentimes, vegetation management gets a very tiny amount of the budget. And so there's a lot of things that need to be done, but there isn't the staffing or the resources to get them done. So Measure C is going to address that. So I'm really looking forward to that. Hopefully it'll pass and we'll be off and running. And then Captain Brackett or Firefighter Prince, is there anything you'd like to add? Any activities that have taken place that you'd like to share with the group? Thank you both.
I think even though it is a pilot program, I think the Pulse Point is, or the Direct Connect has been very beneficial just on a day-to-day basis. We actually are in our CAD system, they are in there now, so comm center is aware, so dispatching is requested and they have a car, and so they can get to a call, within however many minutes from where they are, so it is very beneficial. Nothing else, we got the Little League parade coming up, we got the softball parade coming up in the next 2 weekends, which is always kind of a fun event to be a part of. So, and we're on duty.
Based. Thank you for doing that. As kind of a visiting fire chief, and it's been my honor. I know that Chief White will take over soon, but I want
you.
I have another one.
You said April 15th, and our next meeting is the 14th.
I agree, and I won't disappear. I promise you that. But I'd like you to know that you have a great fire department. You have excellent employees. They're very capable. They're very well trained. They integrate very well with San Rafael. It really acts as one department. They're just a bunch of high achievers, and I'm very proud to work with them, and I just want you to know that.
Thank you. Chief, may I make a comment about the fire department in public? In the years, 48 years that I've been here, I can only give two thumbs up to all. And all remember the nights in the middle of the night when they showed up with my wife would have her Crohn's attack. And they knew, and Big John was there, and they took care of it, and they would show up. But I also remember the time I had a stove fire, and they all showed up on volunteer night, and they were all pissed off at me because there was no fire. And if you can imagine all the volunteers' hoses all the way up Unionstone, and all the crap I got because I knew most of them. Anyhow, I can only give two thumbs up to the guys, and I always put in my donation to the Firemen's Fund 3 or 4 times a year when they have their events.
There's a term that I like to use, and it's called taking care of business. And your firefighters take care of business, whether it's an emergency or whether it's a Little League parade or anything like that. They step up. I don't have to worry about them. They take care of business. It's great.
That's great feedback. Thank you. Absolutely. Any questions on the chief report?
No.
Okay, I have a couple. A little bit, I'm going to try and articulate this. It's a little bit of a nested question, but 5 years ago, when I was sitting on the fire commission, we used to get an activity report that had every single call that was made. And I noticed on the, and I'm jumping a little bit ahead here, but this is what I always do. I noticed in the minutes that we have a fire commissioner who continues to harp on whether or not they can get actual addresses. Mm-hmm. At one point in time, we were told by a former board member who was also a lawyer that was, I believe she said, against HIPAA regulations to publish that. I don't know that for a fact, but for whatever reason, we stopped having that actual address. We would show, I think, a street address or something. A street, but not the actual address. So a couple questions. The reason I was most interested in that was precisely what Direct Connect is attempting to achieve, and that is, do we have people who are calling every single day for transport? And that would have helped us identify those people. The former chief said, we know that without giving you the details. The fire commission doesn't need to know that. I guess my curiosity question is, what does San Rafael get?
We don't provide...
The
fire commission?
They don't get... they don't receive any kind of report on calls.
They do not?
No.
Okay.
If you look at Pulse Point, it doesn't give you the address number of a residence.
Right.
Again, that's a privacy issue. And
right.
It leads towards HIPAA.
Yes.
And it's you know, if you can imagine if you had a loved one that had recurring medical emergencies, you probably would not want to see that published in a public record anywhere, because then everybody would have common knowledge of that. It's just kind of an invasion of privacy. I remember years ago, newspapers used to publish incidents, whether they were police or fire or medical, and they give the person's full name and address
right,
of
right.
the location. And you just don't see that anymore. And again, it leans back towards the HIPAA privacy issues. So the fire officials, the fire chief, the battalion chiefs, we keep a close eye. Again, it's those frequent 911 users. Mm-hmm. It kind of leads back to the pilot project, the pilot program, what that is trying to address. We know where our kind of our hotspots are.
Right.
Okay, they're usually the retirement facilities.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, or they're medical facilities. Those generate the most calls.
Mm-hmm.
But we really don't want to publish somebody's address of you know, who might have had an emergency. That's kind of private information. You just don't want to see that published.
Yes,
I believe that we had on our notes from the meeting last week that we are going to look into the exact verbiage and laws against this so that we can finally...
Unfortunately, that's just going to take some time.
It's
because
going to take
we've
some time,
some,
but that way we have a budget.
We've got some priorities now that have kind of taken over, like COVID. So.
Yes. I would say, without doing any research or expending any time whatsoever on this, we should put that issue to bed once and for all and not have it brought up in the fire commission meeting again.
Can I make a comment?
What?
I actually think that these grids kind of go above and beyond and lay out a good thing of what it's doing. And to your point, Jeff, I mean, Chief Sennett and I have certainly discussed this. I'm in agreement with the notion of that is information that is private. It would maybe help, and maybe I can prepare this for the next meeting if the board simply puts together a brief policy or an amendment in the bylaws that says this information will not be provided.
Great. I'll work on it. Yeah, I mean, let's just stop spending the time on stuff that has no value and is absolutely contrary to law.
Well, at the end of the day, the commission serves that. And this is a commissioner, and to your point, it seems to come up again.
The other thing, too, is there's not really anything you can do with it.
There's no value to it.
There's, the commission can't really take any action on it. What are you going to do, direct the fire department not to respond in that incident?
Well, that's the point.
So it's like it's irrelevant. It might be of personal interest.
I think it's a personal interest
well,
issue. And yeah. We are trying to convince the person in question to drop
okay.
it.
Okay, all right.
Central Fire Commission gets no information on that.
And I believe we're going to stop getting the maps. We're just going to get this one out.
We just felt that the maps, I think the general consensus was they're kind of irrelevant. They just really don't provide much usable information. But
we were providing it for the person who wanted it, but he said that, or she said that they felt that that map wasn't providing them the information they wanted. So instead of wasting their time, we're going to just have these grants instead of those maps. This is
okay.
Okay.
All right. Fair enough. So the
yeah.
Okay. Are we on? Excuse me. On something else. Are we on? Are we still on item F2, the chief officer report, or we have not got there yet?
I think we actually breezed through that type of thing.
We
yeah.
did. Okay.
Yeah,
all right.
You kind of missed past the next part.
Well, I broached that in my comment.
That's quite all right. They comment on either.
Yeah.
That's what we're looking to do right now.
Anything else? Steven?
Yeah. First of all, I want to thank the chief for complimenting our guys. It's always wonderful to hear that. We all know that, those of us who pay attention. We've got a good bunch of guys, and you're probably a pretty good chief because they're not complaining. So, but I also want to commend you in your preparation work. And I actually have some questions. I've been studying a little bit about the coronavirus. My wife was in Asia just last week, and so I was real concerned about what was going on. And one of the things I looked at was how they reacted during the Spanish flu times. And one of the lessons from that was that the survival rate, when things got really bad, was dependent on the nursing care that people received. The women who would go in and make sure people were getting fed, everything gotten taken care of. I think that if this hurricane blows through here, our guys are going to get a lot of overtime, maybe too much overtime. You guys are going to be completely strapped, and you're going to need a volunteer contingent to help do some of that intermediary care, not in the hospital, just looking in on people. And I don't know if there's a countywide initiative, or you have it in San Rafael, or maybe it's something that we should broach the county with, is some sort of volunteer response above and beyond what you have in the volunteer firefighters themselves. So,
sure. You know what? I would like to pose that to Health and Human Services, which is kind of driving all of the protocols right now. So
right.
I'll definitely pitch that to them.
Something like, basically Meals on Wheels plus a little extra. We really do need that. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. I think we're done with that. The next fire commission meeting is April 7th.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So we've done park and rec matters. We have.
Thank you, John.
Thank you.
Lucas in class this week, I think, right?
Mm-hmm.
Eric, do you have anything to add?
On the park and rec
minutes?
I don't, because I actually was not at this meeting. I was at home sick and also nursing a sick 4-year-old at the same time. So, I wound up missing a couple of days there last week. So I don't have any comments on the meeting itself. If there's any questions, I can do my best to answer them.
Anything?
It was John Campo went mm-hmm. through a really detailed presentation of the path that they're going to
Ponte.
The decommission of the Ponte and the building the new trail that's going all. It's huge trail.
Is it still going to be called the Ponte Trail or not?
I don't know what they're going to call it, but the trailhead is going to start off the bike path that goes up the hill into to Novato.
So oh yeah, they've along the freeway.
That, and that'll take you up to where the water tower is, up above Heatherstone, and then from there, it's gonna wind. And it is going to wind
like saddlebacks or something.
Like, oh yeah, yeah. Nice turns if you're on a bike that you're going to be able to utilize those turns. It's going to be really interesting when they finish it. It's going to be another way. I think it's 4.6 miles long. It's windy.
From a status standpoint, how far along are they?
They're a lot further than I thought they were going to be because I was up there 2 weeks ago and they've gotten a lot done.
They're a lot further than they thought they were going to be because the weather conditions have been so cooperative.
For them. They're talking about so the fall.
Finishing it
by the fall.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, and to Bill's point of the meandering, I mean, it's all being done to trail standards, so there's no grade that exceeds certain percentages.
7%.
7%, right. So as opposed to the Pawnee Fire Road, which had like 20% grades and certain grades on it. So it's, and they've already done a lot of the decommission. I got to get back up there again. I've been up there since the very beginning, but
they've done a lot of work since you've been up there.
Yeah, it's going to be just a world-class trail.
So with, all the cutbacks and the switchbacks and stuff like that, are these wide enough so all of these arguments between pedestrians and bicyclists and horses, equestrians, those are going to be taken care of?
Yep. Okay. Yeah, it's a multi-use trail, which I think is a minimum of, did he mention
60
wide, I think, yeah.
Oh, it is?
Uh-huh. Yeah. So it's, just the machinery that creates the trails alone is massive. I mean, they had to reconfigure Queenstone a little bit to get their equipment up there, and then they're bringing Queenstone back to original condition. All that's part of the agreement. The fact that the county's doing all of this work, this is going to be just a world-class trail. It's going to be really nice, a big model for other projects moving forward. John Campo has been the lead on this, has done an amazing job on it, and all the building crews and the county and everything else. This is he should be really proud. This is a great, great, great project. He's
when they finish it, it's going to be pretty awesome.
Sounds very promising.
It would be the John Campo Trail.
The John Campo
Trail. I believe Pawnee Ridge Trail is what they call it.
Pawnee Ridge. Thank you. Wonderful. Anything else on the Park and Rec minutes?
May I make a comment?
Yes, go ahead, Stephen.
Okay, so Jeff, to your point, the arguments, what happens between cyclists and equestrians and hikers is, I'm a little concerned from what I've heard. I'd like to verify this, but if you don't have a line of sight where the cyclist knows that a horse or a person's walking, that's what really creates the conflict. So if it's winding back and forth and it's you don't have that line of sight, it's kind of a problem. I don't know, I haven't been involved in this from the beginning. I'm a little concerned because I know John's a big cyclist enthusiast and it sounds to me like a single track versus a multi-use trail, but I guess I'll leave that judgment to later. So I don't think we actually have that answer until we inspect the trail. This should be a concern for all of us who like to walk out in the woods because, I don't mind cyclists being out there, but I don't like being run down by cyclists either. There's the minutes. Okay, so the next thing is the report, right? So I have something from the report, but I can wait on that.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
All right, having said that, nice and thorough, we move to the PNR maintenance activity report. Does the board have any questions or comments on the report?
I guess I'll make a comment about the Raise the Glass. It went really well. It seemed like we have a great turnout. Moving forward as board members, if we're going to have a table for questions, it should be very clearly marked what we're sitting there for. We got some really great questions, just none of which having to do with our district. Questions about where wineries were located, childcare, did we get more bread? So great questions, we're happy to help with all of the questions, but I think that maybe a sign saying, you know, board member is here to answer questions or something, maybe something more snappy than that, or even possibly having a little line item on the flyer saying, you know, your board members will be there if you have any questions.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Oh, yeah, okay.
But,
well, that's reasonable.
Isabel and I sat there, except for the last half hour.
Did you reach out to anybody?
I smiled at everybody who walked by and I said, do you have any questions for us? And I was, a lot of people were not in district.
Okay.
So they didn't have any questions about the district because they just came for the event.
Got it.
And people who did have questions had questions that were not quite for us.
That were event oriented?
Yes.
Okay, all right. Well, thank you for your attempt.
We're trying.
Yes, understood. Okay, anything else?
Can I just put down a couple things before you move on this one?
Absolutely.
One, obviously Luke's not here tonight. We sent Luke off. He is in Southern Cal for the week, participating in a multi-day workshop that will end with him getting his playground inspector certification. Victor, as he put in his report, did this for us. He went through his last round of certifications literally like within a week or two before he left. So we need one of these on site, otherwise we have to pay people to come in and do it. When you have somebody on site, you can move it through a lot quicker. We're totally in compliance at this point in time based on how often they have to be inspected. But so he is going through that process. He volunteered to do it. So we sent him down there because these workshops don't happen all the time and we need this place. So. That is why Luke is not here tonight, and I commend him for being willing to take on this responsibility. Typically, it's been performed by the park maintenance staff, so for him to do it, I think it's great. And then secondarily, just on the summer program registration, I just certainly wanted to highlight that. It opened for residents last Monday. It opened for non-residents this Monday. I don't think the phone stops ringing for more than 3 minutes at any point during the day, and we've had lines in the morning. Several of the camps are already moving on the waiting lists. They exceeded, as they seem to do every year. Their opening week had a 12% increase over the same period last year. So they are certainly moving right along with it. So kudos to the entire office staff for managing the blitz calls, people coming in, the questions, the registrations, the people trying to sign up, people trying to get into the registration system so that they can sign up, everything else. They've done a tremendous job being there early, opening up early, being very patient with people. So I just hats off to everybody in the office who has been interfacing with them and done a really good job. And Robin's done a good job in putting everything together. So kudos to the rec staff for all that.
I did mention just to Robin, but I don't know if we should have it in the notes too. Myself and a couple of other people were wondering if it was possible to have an online program updated so that more than one of a camp can be put in as a wish list. So like for the specialty camps that have a range of kids, you can only put in one of the wish list. You can put in two.
Not really, but that would be a question for Robin and or Carolyn.
Okay.
We are limited by
the program,
the software allows us
to
do.
And I'm sure that that's
a limit of
it, but
take that
more
of a technical question. I certainly don't have the answer to.
Yeah.
They don't have any type of registration system.
I wonder why.
They're smart.
Given the hope that this will be a relatively normal summer as
yes.
opposed to not. Is Miller Creek still in play for us now that they're back?
You mean as a facility?
As a facility.
I don't know. I don't have an answer for you.
Oh, okay.
So that would be a good broader question.
Okay.
Happy to get the
answer. Well, I can tell you that I signed up for a specialty class that is being at Miller Creek.
Okay.
So,
yeah. All right.
Yes.
Good. Well, my anticipation was that we had a little bit of a downturn in attendance as they were under construction last year.
Yeah.
And with them returning, you know, hopefully that would give us another venue.
Yeah. Yeah, and I will say, too, the other really popular program has been the overnight camp. I think they are already looking on the wait lists for that know, so they've done a good job on that particular.
Where does that take place?
Walker Creek.
Oh, yeah, okay. Been there before.
I'm more.
Excellent. Other questions, comments? Bill?
Yes, Eric, do you have a, or does Luke have a contingency if this virus or hurricane or whatever you want to call it hits and all of a sudden the numbers aren't there?
Well, that's what we talked about at the beginning of the meeting. That was that question that was asked. So it was, at this point in time, no, we're still, you know, everybody's kind of taking it as it comes and figuring it out.
Yeah.
Steven?
Okay, yeah, so what is a successful community event, summer program, et cetera? What is the criteria? I know that at times you all, it's been said by numerous board members that, hey, we're not a business, we don't make money, it's, you know, hopefully we break even. But we actually never get to see the numbers, so we don't know what is actually going on. We have a something that's saying that we had a successful event, people from outside the district attended. We also had a raffle and there was $500 raised for our summer camp. You know, well, what's going on here? What I mean, how much did we pay the musicians? How much expenses did we have? How much income did we bring in? How do we evaluate what we're doing as a district, whether it's worth our while or whether we should be renting out the space instead? I will give it another try, but I think that we should be limiting the events that serve alcohol here inside this facility. We are a family-oriented community, and I think we shouldn't be relying on the sales of liquor to fund stuff. I don't know, guys. I mean, you're very defensive when I say, hey, there's a secret fund, or you're not being honest with us, but you're actually not telling the public anything about what's going on. Now, I'd like to give you the benefit of the doubt, but how I can't, there's nothing to go on. This is the summer camp raffle. Well, what does that mean? It means you're going to discount some summer camp scholarships, or, you know, scholarships. That's great. Who's deciding who's worthy of that scholarship? I mean, there's lots of questions here. It's basically not very accountable, and you do the art show and the same thing. There's money that comes in, and it always seems, no matter how much money gets generated, it all goes out. And that may be okay, but shouldn't we know how much is going out? You're certainly not shy about asking for taxes. Why can't we have information about how those taxes are spent and how our facility is being utilized for the community?
Okay, thank you. Okay. If there are no other questions on the main park and rec maintenance activity report, the next PNR commission meeting will be March 24th.
I just have one other request, and that is that we increase the amount of sanitization of this facility, especially this room, because we have preschoolers in it. Our bathrooms, our porta potties, everything should be doubled right now for the next few months. And I would like you to instruct Eric and staff to do that.
Okay, thank you.
Or we can wait until it hits.
Okay, we're moving on to item H, board member items of interest, requests for future agenda items. Does anyone on the board have such a request? Okay, well, clearly we brought up some know, the cause of the day. I'm sure that that's going to be something that will resonate through several of the sections of the agenda next time, and not necessarily be its own agenda item, but, you know, that's clearly got everyone's attention. Okay.
Yeah, I would just say, work towards it as best we can, contingency plan, or a budget that we kind of be aware of if the money, the funds don't come in, we still have the expenses, what would things look like?
Yeah, to some extent, I mean, some sensitivity analysis would probably be wise, but again, a lot of, you know, several of the programs, not all, several of them, if the revenue goes away, so does the expense.
Yeah.
Not in all cases.
Right.
So, I'm sure Eric has that.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, does anyone in the public have anything that they'd like to see on the agenda next time?
I'd say a group hug, but that would not be appropriate.
Handshake.
No, not a handshake.
I'll give you an elbow anytime, and not a sharp elbow, a friendly elbow.
Okay, hearing done, do I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
All right, Leah and Bill, thank you very much, and thanks everybody for attending.
Thank you.
Oh, great.
Getting the Japanese. Remember what I showed that?
My God.